The year is 1964. Bernard Boucicault, a diplomat for the French embassy in Beijing, attends a Christmas party thrown by a high embassy official. The diplomat gets a drink for his date, a tall, gorgeous blonde working as a secretary for the British. On his way back to his date with a cocktail in his hand, he notices a slim man surrounded by other guests. The man is the only Chinese national at the party. Bernard introduces himself. The man's name is Xia Pei Pu. They get to talking. The man's French is fluent, he teaches Chinese to the wives of the diplomats, and he is a screenwriter and opera singer. The two strike up a friendship. As their purely platonic friendship continued, they felt more and more comfortable with each other and started sharing secrets. Pei Pu told Bernard of an old Chinese tale, about a girl named Zhu. Zhu would dress and live as a boy to be able to attend school, where she met her classmate, Liang. Over the next 3 years, they fell in love. Zhu's father, however, had arranged for her to be married to another man from a prominent family. The news of this made Liang take his own life. Before her marriage, Zhu went to visit Liang's grave, where she threw herself in to be with her love at last. The souls of the two lovers turned into butterflies and flew away together. Pei Pu told Bernard that Zhu's story is his story too. After the births of his sisters, his parental grandmother gave his mother an ultimatum. If she wanted to remain in the family, their third child had to be a boy. But alas, Pei Pu was born a girl. Her mother and the midwife arranged to raise her as a boy to secure their place as part of the family. Bernard listened, understood, and accepted. Shortly after this revelation, he started looking at Pei Pu differently and started pursuing a romantic and sexual relationship. The beginning of this new relationship was not glamorous at all. It was stale and distant and rarely physical. Whenever they engaged in sexual activity, it was rushed and in the dark. Pei Pu had continued to live as a man and only show her true self when with Bernard. Eventually, Bernard's duties in China came to an end. Shortly before leaving, he was told by Pei Pu that she was pregnant. Bernard promised to be back no matter what it takes. Bernard kept his promise and eventually came back to China. He immediately began searching for his lover and possibly his child. In the meantime, Mao Zedong's cultural revolution was on the rise, which did not allow foreigners to mix with the Chinese. But in spite of this, Bernard continued his search. When they finally met, under the pretense of Pei Pu teaching him about the cultural revolution, she told him that he has now a son, who had to be sent away and hidden due to him being half European. Their rendezvous continued for a while, until Pei Pu was to be replaced as his teacher by someone else. Kang, the replacement, showed up to Pei Pu's house when Bernard was there. Out of fear that Kang might be with the law enforcement, he offered to disclose documents that he could obtain with the help of his position as an archivist at the French embassy. Thus, the relationship was allowed to continue. In 1973, Bernard finally met his son. Since the country was becoming more and more liberal, Pei Pu deemed it safe for them to meet. They did not live happily ever after, however, as 2 weeks later Bernard's visa had run out. Bernard, living in France, no longer a diplomat, and in a relationship with a man, became restless as he wanted to be with Pei Pu and his son. He asked his current lover, Thierry, to aid him in bringing them to France. Thierry, even though not excited about the prospect of sharing his lover, complied and helped bring Pei Pu and their son to Paris, where they all started living together. Pei Pu continued performing in the opera and maintaining her image as a man in case of a need to return to China. Bernard, however, no longer felt romantically attracted to her and saw the relationship as an obligation. During the surveillance of Chinese diplomats, the French government started looking into Bernard and Pei Pu. The 500 missing documents at the Embassy of France in Beijing and Mongolia, both places where Bernard had previously worked, and the fact that he was now living with a Chinese national, asked for drastic measures. They were both arrested within a week of each other. While awaiting trial in his cell, Bernard learned things about Pei Pu he could not fathom. Things he could not imagine to be true, especially after their almost 2-decade-long relationship. Xia Pei Pu was a biological male, and their son was a fake. The charade was broken. Not long after, Bernard attempted suicide in jail. Xia Pei Pu was renowned as an opera singer even as a teen and would often play female roles. The practice of cross-dressing in China actually comes from the Ming and Qing dynasties, a time where theater flourished, but also a time where men and women could not perform on stage at once, as it was considered improper. Thus, all male or all female casts playing both genders began forming. Pei Pu, being an opera singer and practicing cross-dressing on stage since his teens, had gotten pretty comfortable with the role of a woman. He then studied at Yunnan University, where he learned the French language, which later proved extremely useful. Bernard Boursicot, a romantic and a thrill-seeking adventurer, while not having distinguished himself in any particular way in school, still managed to get an accountant position in the French embassy in Beijing. Before moving to China in his 20s, he had sexual encounters with fellow male students, which he disregarded as a schoolboy's game, and decided to seek women as an adult. Didn't work out for him, did it? There are quite a few tricks used by people that kind of explain how did Bernard not realize that he was dealing with a man for 18 years. Keep in mind that there was no surgery and people had full, intact male genitalia. Bernard said that in a good month they would have sex maybe twice, and when they did, people always took charge and guided Bernard. The sex was rushed, cold, and usually in the dark, something that Bernard attributed to Chinese modesty. At times he would give in to people completely, who'd finish him off with oral and his hands. The little imperfections about Peipu's bodies that Bernard could have noticed were easily explained by supposed hormones that he was taking to reinforce his masculinity. Now one question remains. The penis. How is it possible that he only found out that Peipu, the mother of his child, is a male only through a medical exam ordered by the French government when investigating their espionage? It's all rather convoluted really, and quite elegant. During the investigation, Peipu gave a detailed explanation as to how he went above and beyond in presenting as a woman for as long as he did.
The way he was able to trick so many men, well, actually we don't know how many men, we don't know about Bernard, but the point is that he explained this to the police when they interrogated him. Like, I'm not making this shit up, is my point. He pushed his balls up into himself almost, and then only the sack was hanging on, off, and then he would put his dick like this, he would bisect his testicles, and then the skin would create a little like thing, it would look like vaginal lips. And Bernard never seen a vagina before. So for him this looked normal. He also had a triangle of hair over here, and there was also penetration. I don't know how they did that. But this definitely looks like a vagina. I would also like to apologize.
Okay, so I definitely got way too excited with the reenactment here, and I kept rambling for a very long time, so I'm just gonna delete all that shit and cut to the rest of the video. In the many texts written on the subject, Peipu and Bernard are both described as spies. The spy who fell in love with the shadow, the opera singer who faked being a woman to spy for China, when in fact Bernard was nothing but a lowly accountant, before meeting Peipu and eventually giving documents to the Chinese. The same goes for Peipu, even if he was intentionally enchanting the Frenchman for information, big if there, it later became clear that he couldn't provide any substantial information, but in spite of this, their relationship continued. Bernard's work in the French embassy in Mongolia, a position he got specifically to be closer to Peipu and their son, proved futile and fruitless in terms of spying. Even during the trial, Bernard's counsel pointed out how very much bottom of the ladder in spying terms the information he was providing to the Chinese was. Most compelling, at least in my opinion, is the fact that Peipu moved to France even after knowing that there was nothing to be gained from him for the Chinese. I think it's safe to say that Bernard was fucked hard during all of this. I've seen some comments people saying that he tried to off himself because he found out that his girl was actually a dude. I'm pretty sure that someone who slept with men frequently wouldn't mind a little dick. I'm also pretty sure that it's the almost 20-year-old lie that threw him over the edge. This man thought he was risking his life for his son and his son's mother. From everything I gathered, it does really seem as if Bernard was actually in love with Peipu, at least in the beginning. Him being fine with not seeing Peipu for long periods of time, or not consummating when they were together, amongst other things like selling out his fucking country. Little things like that point to the fact that there were strong feelings there. Even later, when he no longer felt romantically attracted to Peipu, he still fulfilled a duty most fathers wouldn't even dream of, and brought both of them to France. I can't help but feel sorry for both of them. Here you have an extremely sexually inexperienced man enchanted by a tale of foreign mystery, for which he risks his freedom. And even after the mystery is gone, he does a lot to bring Peipu and his child back to his home country, to then only find out that it was all a lie. It was all a 20-year-old continuous lie. There is a penis and there is no child. On the other hand, you have Peipu, who lived in a very repressive country and had to conform to very oppressive norms, but was lucky enough to have found a way to express himself, whether that be on stage or when alone with Bernard. We all play different roles in our lives. You behave differently when you are at work to when you are with your friends. You dress differently too. Even among different friend groups, people you're supposed to be yourself around, you act differently. Now imagine if there was a way you wanted to portray yourself that wasn't allowed, a character trait that was illegal. But then you found a loophole. Two loopholes, in fact. Wouldn't you use them? Are the many roles that we play on a daily basis, based on where we are or who we are with, really that different from what Peipu did here? Yes, yes, they are different. He purchased a fucking child to trick this Frenchman into believing he has a family with him. Their son, Sha Du Du, was adopted at age 4, sold by his mother. Peipu adopted the boy from his family, who are Uyghurs, a long-suffering ethnic group in China, relentlessly oppressed and prosecuted time and time again. When the boy was asked how he felt about the adoption, he had this to say.
It was not that my mother did not love me. We were starving.
In conclusion, I'd like to say that if they were in fact spies, in a sense that most imagine a spy to be, then they were really fucking bad at it. Looking at the documents that Bernard provided to the Chinese, especially later from Mongolia, it is pretty clear that the ones being played here were the Chinese, not the French. Bernard Boussicault and Sha Peipu are probably the worst spies I have ever heard of. Still, I have heard of them. Just perhaps for the wrong reasons.